is, I thought that maybe you'd be marking me and then I'll get a mark after this presentation. So I'm glad to hear that it's quite better than my performance today. The only reason I am here today is because your school, your industrial arts students, build those wonderful stands up there. And the show was first at the airport, International Airport. It was at the City Hall after that. It's here now, and it's moving to your way. And you wouldn't believe how many compliments I personally got about those stands. They are beautiful, wonderfully done. So kudos to you and your school. You know, wondering around the school, I was blown away by some of those sculptures out there done by your welding students. So there's obviously lots of creative life happening here. That's good news. I do have some notes in case I get distracted from what I'm talking about, so I sometimes will refer to them, hopefully not too often. About those pictures, I hope you had the introductory poster there. That talks about the history. It talks about the Prague Spring, which started around 1965 and kind of ended in 1968 when we had the invasion by the Soviet forces. The other story, and that part is the pictures I took. And it's a little bit of like a personal diary. I don't know if you had a chance to look at it, but there's handwriting on it. That's my handwriting. I hold it on the images after I printed. So it's a little bit of a diary and my memory going back 50 years to try to recall what it was like at that time. It's a very personal story. The other side it is from about 22 years later when actually what we were trying to do in 68 happened, and that was that the communist dictatorship disintegrated and you know, lots of freedoms and things started to happen. And those pictures are about a person who ended up leading that movement. He was an amazing human being. He was not a politician, that was his last intention. He was a writer, dissident, playwright. He spent time in jail. And then, you know, after getting out of jail, a few short months after, he becomes the president of the country. But he was most importantly, he was a very unassuming, normal guy who attracted lots of affection, as you can see in those pictures. He also became a bit of a celebrity on the world stage, and that's why there are pictures with very famous people there, like Dalai Lama, Margaret Thatcher, and all those kind of people. The guy who took the pictures, I never really met. I talked to him and we were trying to put it together. He still lives in Prague, in Czech Republic. I did get to know him when he came over here for the exhibition. Really good guy. He's quite well-known photographer. He's recognized worldwide. He won some world awards, world press awards. So he's a well-known photographer. And he would be the first one to tell you that it was a bit of a fluke that he became Václav Havel's personal photographer. And because of Havel's personal traits, he had access to everything. Like, he didn't edit it. This was not trying to control his image or try to move something he was not in. I think as Sally mentioned, when I took those pictures to move on, I was your age. 1965, I would have been 16. The invasion happened just a few days after my 19th birthday. So I was I'm sure that we don't change all that much as far as our aspirations. So I suspect that you have the same dreams like I would have when I was your age. But we do change. 50 years later, I'm a very different person than I was. I'm different than I was a year ago. Actually, I'm probably different than what I was when I woke up this morning. I'll be different after this experience talking to you. And you will be the same. There's no way 50 years from now you will be like you are now. Not like you were in junior high when you graduated, you will be different. And that's a good thing. The age I was in and you are in now is really formative age. That's when a lot of directions are taken through all the chaos of this time, which will decide what you will be like when you are adult. So it's a really good age to be in, and you should see it as a good opportunity for it. And this is actually where photography is very powerful, because photography does freeze the moment and shows you how things change. I'm sure if you look at a selfie from a couple of years ago, you will be saying, who was that individual on that selfie? Because you have grown and changed over time. So what was important to me in 1960s? Probably the number one thing was freedom. Living under a dictatorship, you have very few freedoms. You don't really can say what you want. You don't even have a freedom in deciding what you want to do with your life. You don't have freedom to travel. You don't have freedom to read what you want to read. You don't have freedom to get the information you want. So that was our yearning, and that's why that whole movement started in 68 and then later in late 80s. However, freedom is a very fickle thing, because we can't have unrestricted freedom. I can't go and drive down just driving 150 kilometers an hour. I don't have the freedom to help somebody. Our freedoms are balanced with society, and it's a moving target. I was visiting I was in the States a couple of months ago, and I had a discussion with some very smart, young people. Not young, they were, sorry, for you they would be older, kind of 30s. And they were defending their freedom to carry guns. And I was blown away by the rhetoric, what they were saying, because it didn't make any sense to me that I need to carry guns. And that other people should have that kind of gun. But they thought that's an essential freedom for them. So it is something which changes. A few years back, probably during your time, gay people couldn't marry. Right? Now they can and accept it. So it's a moving target. And it's something which was very easy to see how unfree I was in the 60s. That was very obvious. Now it's much more difficult to see what our restrictions on our freedom are and what is the right balance, right? How is Facebook controlling my freedoms to choose what I'm going to have, what I'm going to read? How is my own prejudice restricting my freedom to get out of the box I'm in? So, the freedom is something which is very, very important and shouldn't be given up. Because what happens, the other side, there's a good side of balancing freedom for society's sake, but there's a bad side, because the freedom is what people take away in order to control you. Right? So is the freedom I am giving up good for the society? Or is the freedom I'm giving up good for somebody else? Profit or power or control? So you are living in a far more ambiguous age. It's much more difficult to make these decisions. You have to be much wiser than I was. I was being hit over the head by my unfreedom. So for you it's you know, it's something which is challenging, but I know that you are going to handle that really well. The other thing which was important then and it's important now is belonging. Belonging to a group, belonging to some friends, having a sense of my own self and not being judged and all this kind of stuff. But the invasion taught me a very powerful lesson. Because what happened was, you know, we woke up one morning and there was like these hundreds of tanks everywhere and all this kind of stuff. But I literally hundreds, there was a lot of them in my city, Prague. It would be a little bit like if you woke up tomorrow morning and there's all these foreign soldiers on your street, these guns and things, and you didn't know if you can step out to your front door because you may get shot. That was the kind of a feeling. But what happened as a result, the people in Prague really pulled together. And I talked about it in the pictures a little bit. We became one tribe because and we had this one common enemy, the soldiers. Which was a very exciting feeling. I was 19, that was lots of, I don't want to say fun, but it was exciting. I mean, my God, I was pumped, right? The morning I came up. Now, because I was taking pictures, photography was my thing at the time, I wanted to take pictures of the soldiers. And the first couple of days, I could climb on top of a tank, go to a soldier like this, and take a picture. And they let me do that for the 2 days. It was fine. But what I discovered, that those soldiers were 18, 19-year-old kids, just like me. They were petrified, they were terrified. They were all Russian from, in Prague, or some other nationalities, but in Prague they were all Russian. So these kids came from some small village in the middle of Russia, which, you know, is bigger than Canada. And these kids lived in an environment and they knew absolutely nothing about the world because the system controlled all the information they could get. We were living close to the western border. We could listen to radio view or affiliate. Our parents lived in democracy, so they would tell us what democracy is all about. So we knew other things besides what we were told. But these kids in Russia, they knew absolutely nothing. They thought they were coming in time to save us from the evil capitalists who came in to enslave us. So they were expecting that we'll welcome them. Thank you for coming and, you know, saving us. But instead they were met by our outrage, total outrage. And, you know, we spoke Russian, many of us did. We had to learn that in school, you know. I wasn't very good at it, but spoke a little bit. So you talk to these kids and they were, their worldview was turned upside down. It's like what you believed 100% all of a sudden is not true. So what I learned from that I don't really belong to my tribe, but I really belong to the humanity as a whole. Because those kids were just like me. And we started as enemies, but I could see that they had the same thing I had. They felt like I did. And you know, fear and tribalism is that if we all saw each other as human beings rather than enemies, I think there would be lots less wars, there would be lots less problems. You know, because these things are picked up often and used by people to gain and keep power. We have to scare somebody about somebody else, and then we offer to protect you. And that's a very yeah, it's a tool which has been used for a long time, from ancient times in Europe, and there was lots of religious wars. It was used by Stalin, it was used by Hitler. Make somebody scared about somebody else, and then say, I'll protect you, we have to stay tight. It's happening even now in some places, as you probably know. importance of having purpose and meaning in life. Once again, it was much easier for me to have a meaning, because there's a paradox that if things are difficult, if the external things are difficult, meaning is easier to have a purpose. I'm trying to make things better for myself. I'll try to make things better for my family, for my friends, for my community. But if things are easy, it's much more difficult to have a meaning. It's easy to get caught up in distractions, meaningless distractions. You know, and it's a roller coaster. You know, I get a new car. Materialism is one of them. I get a new car. It's a new car, great, but you know, a few months later, it's not a new car anymore, so I have to get a new one. Some people do it with relationships, right? Which is worse than getting a new car. And a lot of that is driven by not really knowing, you know, why we are here and what we want to be achieving. One way to get around it, so it's more difficult for you, because these are Canada right now. It's probably the easiest place in the world to live, right? We are very blessed. I'm blessed. I realize it every day. But it creates its own challenges, because we don't want to, you know, the lack of meaning. I could get caught up in addictions, drugs, but it could be also video games, or it could be I'm just killing my time. But one thing which anybody can do anytime is to adopt a purpose or meaning when you are trying to, when you look inside and you start to consider how you could improve yourself, how you could make yourself a better person, better human being. You know, I have this quote to Prague. It's from, I don't know if you know the guy, he lived almost 200 years ago, Ralph Waldo Emerson. And yeah, he was a wonderful thinker and a humanist. And this is a quote from him, so I'll read it out to you. To be truly human, discover your unique inner power and consciously develop and nourish it. Yeah, that's a pretty brilliant way how to spend your life, right? Because it's not easy to discover what your inner power is. That's the first challenge, how to find it. But once you find it, then, you know, consciously nourishing it is really good. Okay, I'll mention one more story which I love, and that's from, it's a native story. And there was this old chief talking to his grandkids, and he was describing them. You may have heard this story. If you do, please excuse me. But it was he was describing that in every human being, there are two wolves which live in every single human being. One wolf is good, one wolf is bad, and they battle each other all the time. The bad wolf is anger and fear and jealousy and all those kind of bad things, and the good wolf is, you know, compassion and love and giving and, you know, joy. Joy is really the big positive for us. So the kids listen, and then one of the kids says, "Granddad, you know, which wolf wins?" And the granddad says, "The one you feed." Because we all have those tendencies, and the question is, which wolf do I choose to feed, right? Which is my decision. So to do all this, you have to be engaged. You have to be engaged in life. You have to be engaged in trying to do. And I know that all of you are engaged. And you know, when I walk into this school and I sense the energy, it's really wonderful to see. Because you live in a complicated world, which is getting more complicated all the time. I lived in a relatively simple world, but you live in a more complicated world with more ambiguous things happening. So it's in many ways more difficult for you. But the reason, the biggest reason you should So it's your world that you are creating and you are starting now. And young people have an enormous influence and power. 1968 Prague, students, young people, they drove so many things. Velvet Revolution, same thing. You know, look at how US stopped the pointless, stupid Vietnam War. Was mostly because of the students who got engaged and young people. So you do have that, this power. You know, even now in States, the high school kids or whatever who are pushing the ban on guns and things like that. So it's there. My generation are leaving you a bunch of issues, right? Which you will have to, deal with. You know, environment is one of them. Political things come and go, but if all of a sudden, it's hard for people to live on this earth, then that's a big issue, right? So there's a whole bunch of things which you will do, but there's also lots of exciting things happening out there. You know, unfortunately, the media and our own human nature is that we tend to look at the disasters, the negative, this, that, and that. There's so much positive thing happening when you look at it. High school is a very positive thing. Those metal stack